There's a place for all our heroes. It's called the Hall of Fame. The greats of sports are honored here for the way they played the game. As we count their contributions, we feel so very proud. We won't forget how much they gave.
From Drumlin's Country Club in Syracuse, Tully's Good Times proudly presents the 2014 Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame Induction Ceremony on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our magnificent celebration. Tonight, six individuals will join our prestigious Hall of Fame. Syracuse and the greater Syracuse area carry a rich tradition of excellence in sports. Tonight's honorees have brought such distinction to their community, their sports, and to themselves. Saluting them as we are tonight is not only appropriate, it is absolutely necessary. Tonight, because of them, the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame becomes even greater. Please allow me to introduce our distinguished head table. Beginning on my far right, from the great game of golf, Hall of Fame inductee, T. Cleland. From basketball, Hall of Fame inductee, Phil Gordon. Representing Hall of Fame inductee from football, Mike Hart, Mike's mother, Rory Rushlow Hart. Our Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame president, Jim Battaglia. On my far left, from sports journalism, Hall of Fame inductee, Bob Snyder. From basketball, Hall of Fame inductee, Father Bill Jones. And from the game of football, Hall of Fame inductee, Gerhard, Schwedes. Ladies and gentlemen, our distinguished head table. At this time, it's our pleasure to recognize current Hall of Famers who are in attendance tonight. Will they all please stand? All current Hall of Famers, please stand so we can show you on television. Now it's time to begin our induction ceremony. Each honoree will be introduced by videotape. We will then hear from each honoree. Our first inductee, Phil Gordon.
Just call him Coach. That's what he's been and always will be. Philip Coach Gordon has instructed youngsters in how to play the game the right way since the late 1950s. Gordon had played the big three sports at Nottingham, earning 8 letters. He was Syracuse's 1951-52 Athlete of the Year. At Dean Academy in Massachusetts, he was a three sports star and played on an undefeated New England prep school championship basketball team called the Boys from Syracuse. Phil also played three sports at Cortland State, where he earned his degree as well as his master's in physical education and teaching certification. Teaching elementary physical education and coaching at Chittenango Central began in 1958. Pat Jerome wanted Phil to teach high school phys ed, and for 36 years, he also coached Chittenango's varsity basketball team. Phil demanded discipline, and he got it.
To some administrators, he would have probably should have been a little more, less abrupt and a little more favorable to getting along with the people. But I looked at him as the person who was good at what he did. He didn't mind sharing it with other people. And I really was always on Phil's side.
It was just what you had to do to play for Coach Gordon. And his success was a testimony of he knew what he was doing and what he expected, and he got the most out of the kids that he had on the team.
During the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, Gordon's teams won 8 Tri-Valley titles and 6 times Phil was the league's Coach of the Year. Chittenango won Section 3 crowns in 67 and 77. Coach Gordon, a 31-year member of the Section 3 basketball committee, coached more than 750 games, winning 411, 11th all-time in wins among coaches in the section at the time. Sought after as a public speaker, he's been a basketball camp clinician for decades.
He had the team at the women's building over at Syracuse. He was talking to him what he expected from the Empire team and everything. At the end, he says, "You see this black line?" The kids all go, "Yes, yes," he says. "You cross this line, you're going to war," he says. "And guess what? I'm your general." So that's how he coached. He was the general. He was the boss of the team. There was no doubt about it.
Phil was a coaching fixture at the State Fair All-Star Game. And there were the Monday coaching roundtables at Lemoyne. Phil, Evans, Hall of Famer Jerry Wilcox, Duke McGrath, Tom Cooney, Terry O'Connor, and others, swapping strategies and techniques.
They were teachers first, and that gymnasium became the classroom, and he was in total control of his own classroom, and I think once you establish how good you can teach, you know, you then get the right to keep that classroom for a long time, which you did.
You don't win, you know, over 400 games in a high school career doing the same thing over and over, because, you know, coaches are pretty sophisticated, you're easy to scout, so you need to be have a very dynamic coaching approach.
Phil also coached 2 seasons at Canastota.
But they also needed someone help their program turn around.
Recently, he was a volunteer assistant coach at Fowler, and given the opportunity, Phil would gladly help coach kids this winter. Gordon is already a Hall of Famer, numerous times over. Among those who've inducted him are Section 3 basketball in 1996, New York State basketball coaches in 2004, Chittenango Athletic in 2008, and Nottingham High in 2010. But more than awards and wins, Phil has always been about teaching the right way to play the game, on and off the court.
You don't get it when you're a young kid, but as you get older, you know, hard work, putting the team ahead of yourself, putting your family ahead of yourself. I think those, as he was coaching the game of basketball, he was really coaching life lessons.
Lessons well taught by Phil Coach Gordon, the Veterans Committee selection for induction into the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame, class of 2014. Ladies and gentlemen, Coach Phil Gordon.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank the board of directors for finally voting me in. And I would like to congratulate my fellow inductees. I'm going in with a great class. I wish Mike could have been here. His high school coach was a former student of mine, just in case, so he got the right idea. The reason why I'm up here, one of them, is because of the tremendous support I have always received from my family, sitting down in front of me, from my former players, many of whom are here, from my assistant coaches, some of whom are here, my friends, my old friends, my new friends, and my fellow coaches, who we always traded ideas with. Because to be honest with you, when I started coaching, I didn't know anything about coaching. Who does? I was a player. And playing and coaching the game are two different things. I wouldn't be up here without their help, and they all have a piece of this. I also have to make a special thank you to my team of doctors, for they have kept me vertical for the past 25 years. I must confess that when I was a young man, I was a terror. To be more explicit, I was a Thorndon terror. That was the name of our baseball team at Thorndon Park, and we were pretty good. And one thing about growing up in Thorndon Park, that is where I learned everything good and everything bad. So it evened out pretty well. As a young athlete, I knew the feeling of scoring a touchdown and the disappointment of losing a fumble. I knew the thrill of hitting a home run and the disappointment of striking out with a man on third and less than two down. And I had the thrill of making a game-winning basket against CBA. And I also knew the disappointment of missing a clutch foul shot in the last few seconds of the game. I experienced all of that, all those highs and lows. But none of this prepared me for the emotional roller coaster I would be on in coaching for the next 50 plus years. Yeah, I gotta check my notes out. Well, why did I choose basketball? Because I coach football and I coach baseball. I chose basketball because basketball is my favorite sport. I like the way they dribble up and down the court, just like I'm the king of the microphone, so is Dr. J and Moses Malone. I like slam dunks because they take me to the hoop. My favorite play is the alley-oop. I like the pick and roll. I like the give and go because it's the basketball of Mr. Curtis Blow. You like that? Oh. I used to go to dinner and take the girls to see Tiny play against Earl the Pearl, and Wilt Big O and Jerry West played basketball at their very best. Basketball has always been my thing. I like Magic, Bird, and Bernard King. And number 33, my man Kareem, is the center of my story team. Yeah. I have never considered myself a very religious man, as the people that know me well know that. But I taught the commandments every day in practice, and I'm going to tell you five of them. One, thou shalt not shoot uncontested. Number two, thou shalt not give baseline. Number three, thou shalt always hit the open man. Some people would have trouble with that. Thou shalt never miss the first of a one-on-one. And one more, thou shalt never try to BS the coach. And by the way, these commandments were not multiple choice. I push my teams to the limit every day in practice to become the best player they were capable of becoming. My expectations were always very high for my teams, and my expectations of myself were always very high. I learned very early that failing to prepare is preparing to fail. It was important to me that my kids always presented themselves well wherever they were, in school, downtown, on the bus, at other places. And I always reminded them that they represented the school, the community, their parents, and the coach. So they better do the right thing. It was also important because a lot of young eyes were always watching them, because young kids would come to the games. We played before full houses almost all the time. They would come to the games, and for some reason, they would pick one of the kids to be their hero. So it was up to him to make sure he said and did the right thing all the time. My message to the team was always to set their goals high and work hard at what they did. And a poem I came upon in the late 60s was my message to them for the rest of my career, and it's still a message to everybody, myself and to everybody in here. And it went like this: sometime when you're feeling important, sometime when your ego is in bloom, sometime when you take it for granted that you're the best qualified in the room, sometime when you think that you're going would leave an unfillable hole, just follow these simple instructions and see how it humbles the soul. You take a bucket and fill it with water, and then you put your hand in it up to the wrist. Then you pull your hand out, and the hole that's remaining is a sign of how much you'll be missed. You can stir all you want when you enter. You can splash up the water galore. But wait, and in just a minute, it looks just the same as before. The moral of this quaint example is to do just the best that you can. Be proud of yourself. But remember, there is no indispensable man. Ladies and gentlemen, I am very proud to now be a member of the Greater Syracuse Hall of Fame. Thank you.
Thank you, Coach. Thank you, Coach. The 28th Annual Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame Induction Ceremonies will continue on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Welcome back as Tully's Good Times proudly presents the 2014 Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame Induction Ceremony on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Ladies and gentlemen, our second inductee for 2014, Mike Hart.
Statistics can be deceiving. Not in the case of Mike Hart, whose stats are overwhelming. Mind-boggling, in fact. At Onondaga Central, four national records, career touchdowns, 204, consecutive and total 100-yard rushing games, 47 each, points, 1,246, seven New York State marks, three-time State Player of the Year, three state championships, 46 wins against one loss.
Mike pretty much put him back on the map. It was amazing to go to those games and see no one in the bleachers, and then all of a sudden Mike started playing and they were filled because everyone wanted to know who Mike Hart was.
What made Hart so special?
It was more the fact of his vision and how he could be so elusive out there. And that's what I think made him rise above the rest.
There was also his respect for the game. No showboating. Simply hand the ball to an official after scoring another touchdown. One of Mike's physical stats did deceive a lot of folks, some college coaches among them. He was a little guy playing at a small school. but he was a back possessing great vision of the field, combined with shiftiness and strength, who ran for a state record 11,045 yards, a staggering 11.8 yards per carry. That was number two in the country. Oh, and he played basketball and graduated top 10 in his class. What's not to like? Lack of height?
His senior year in the state championship game, I think he burst. They were losing at halftime, and he came out in the second half for like 300-plus yards.
I wanted him to go away for college. He was always the man of the house. He was always somebody that his brothers always looked up to. Syracuse gave it a great run. People always think that they didn't, but they did. So I wanted him to go away more so than anything. But Michigan was always his love. When he was younger, he wrote this speech that we found, If I Had a Dream, and he always said that he was going to attend the University of Michigan. So once they offered, he was sold on it.
Welcome to the big house. Hart went to Michigan. Mike was Big Ten Freshman of the Year, running for a school frosh record 1,455 yards. As a junior, he ran for 1,562 yards and was fifth in Heisman balloting. Senior Captain Hart ran for 1,361 yards. A three-time All-Conference, he set four Michigan standards, lost only three fumbles in more than 1,000 touches, and completed his four-year degree work early. A sixth-round NFL pick of the Indianapolis Colts, injuries cut his pro playing career to 3 years, but his career included Super Bowl 44.
I mean, he still had some gas in his tank, hampered by injuries, but, you know, he knows his dream is coaching.
First at Eastern Michigan, now as Western Michigan running backs coach. Of all his accomplishments, what has made Mike's mother the proudest?
Not football, believe it or not. It's the person that he is. It's his values, his morals, everything that he stands for. If you took football away, Mike's still going to be Mike.
As special as he was on the field, he's as special off the field. I watched him the other day when he came in for his football camp with his wife and two children, and it was very pleasant to see how good of a father, how good of a husband he was. So obviously you want to be great on and off the field, and he is.
Poyer runs Hart's CNY Football Academy and Mike Hart Football Foundation.
Mike called me about 6 years ago. We've always stayed in touch. And he just said, I have an idea, Mr. Poyer. I'd like to do a free camp for the kids. And I'd appreciate it if you have time to see if you can't take the ball and start running with it. Mike put all the startup money up. We got it rolling. And it's just been taking off for 6 years now.
And now, let's hear from Mike Hart. Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame Class of 2014.
First off, I just want to start out by apologizing for not being able to be in attendance tonight. Obviously, I'm in the middle of football season, and it's tough to get out, so I definitely want to apologize for that. But we can get this thing going now. It's definitely probably one of the weirdest things I've ever done in my life. You know, I'm talking into a camera for a speech. But let me start off by just thanking the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame. You know, board members, I appreciate you guys thinking of me and obviously bestowing me with this great honor. Second of all, I just want to, you know, congratulate all the other inductees. It's a great honor. You know, Syracuse is a special place in all of our hearts, and I'm definitely, you know, really excited to be inducted with the rest of you. But, you know, one thing I think I have and still have was, you know, my values. And those values were taught to me by a lot of people who are in attendance right now. And, you know, first off, you know, I think the number one value that, you know, that I believe in is hard work. And, you know, there's no harder working person I know than my mother. And, you know, she raised, you know, four kids, you know, lost a child, you know, and raised us all by ourselves, you know, by herself. You know, single parent mom, which is hard to do, you know, working all those hours, getting us to practice, you know, getting us video games, cooking dinner, doing all those things. And so at a young age, I think I was taught, you know, one of my values that I was taught at a young age was just hard work. And really there's no excuses. You know, to get, you know, you have to do something, you have to provide for somebody. You got to work hard. And so, you know, first of all, you know, I obviously want to thank my mom, number one, for that. She just instilled the, you know, work ethic in me that allows me to just never quit and never stop. The second thing, you know, second value that, you know, I think that I believe in, it was instilled in me, was just, you know, family. And, you know, like I said, that, you know, my mom was a single parent mom, but, you know, she also had a lot of support from my grandparents who are in attendance tonight. And, you know, just family and, you know, what it really means to be a family. My grandma and grandpa, you know, were always there. Whenever we needed to be picked up, whenever we needed to be dropped off, whenever we needed food, you know, they were always there to support us, to help us get where we had to go. And I really appreciate what you guys do, really appreciate what you do for my mom. You know, when I was with my brothers and my nieces, you know, you guys really have taught me what it means to, you know, to have a family, you know, allow me to be the father I am today to my kids and obviously my wife. So, I would definitely want to thank you guys for just instilling that, you know, family aspect, the family value in my life. The third thing, you know, that I think that really has impacted me is just, you know, my leadership and, you know, the value of leadership in my life. And I think, in high school, I learned a lot and from Bill Spicer and my high school coach. And, you know, he's one of the greatest leaders I've been around to this day. You know, I played for, you know, Lloyd Carr, Tony Dungy, Jim Caldwell, and I've learned just as much from them that I did from Bill Spicer. You know, being a young age in such a crazy time, I like being 14, 15, 16, 17, that's when things usually go good or go bad, and you kind of choose the path that you're on for your life. And, you know, Spicer was always a guy that, you know, I just looked at, you know, and he was a great leader. Just forcing kids to get in the weight room, forcing kids to do what they don't want to do and like it. You know, that's what a great leader is to me, someone that can get someone to do what they don't want to do and actually enjoy doing it. And Bill Spicer just taught me that, you know, in high school. And it's something that's always stuck, you know, that will always stick with me throughout life, is that, you know, the heart, you know, the leadership that he had for that team, for those state championships. And, you know, I really appreciate that. The last value that I think really just kind of sticks to me is that, you know, just that, you know, being motivated and having volition. I think a lot of people are motivated. You know, everybody wants to go to the NFL. You know, everybody wants to be a coach. Everybody wants to do those kind of things. But you have to have the willpower, you know, the volition to do that. And again, someone in attendance that I don't even think he knows, but, you know, I learn from him every day, and that's Mike Poyer. I should say Lisa, because she runs everything in that house. But, you know, Mike is a guy that, you know, it's one of the hardest working men I've ever seen in my life, and a motivated man. You know, a couple years ago, we asked him to put together a camp and help us do this, and, you know, for the All-CNY Football Academy, and he's a guy that, you know, when he's motivated to do something, he's going to get it done. You know, he has the willpower to get all that stuff done. And, you know, I know if I need something done in my life or anything, that, you know, if I call Mike Poyer, Mike Poyer will make sure it happens. Mike Poyer is the reason this video is getting done right now. He hits me up every day about it. So, you know, I just want to thank Mike. And, you know, I really do appreciate, you know, he's someone I look at that, you know, who's really motivated to get things done in life, and he does it. And those are kind of the things that have set me up, I think, for success in my life and will continue to, you know, to set me up for success. So, again, I just want to thank you guys for the award. I'll be back in Syracuse as soon as I can. Again, I'm sorry for not being there. Mom, thank you. Grandma, Grandpa, thank you. Spice, thanks for coming. And obviously, congratulations again to all the other inductees. Take it easy.
Ladies and gentlemen, accepting for Mike Hart, Mike's mother, Rory Rushlow Hart. Congratulations, Mike. Our third inductee, T. Cleland.
Teresa Cleland had always played ball, basketball, volleyball. But after taking up golf in her mid-20s, she eventually decided to take a lesson.
Well, it was 23 years ago, we're at Spinning Wheel, and I think because of her husband being right near there, and I've already had a reputation of being a good instructor, that it was easy to just come there. I was only like 5 minutes from Greater Syracuse Moving and Storage, and that's where it started. And I saw some good things her day one. And at that time, she was shooting around 95.
When did Catalano think T. Cleland could be among the area's better district women players?
After about a year, I says, T, we're over at Rogues Roost Country Club, Golf Club. And I said, you know what? The best tournament in this city is the Babe Saharius. And we're going to go out and win that someday. Multiple ones.
Since 1996, when she won her first major, Cleland has won 4 district championships. And her 5 post-standard amateur titles is a record shared only by Hall of Fame male counterpart Walt Kanich, who won 5 Harold Ams. If Ginny Allen, member of the Hall of Fame's inaugural class in 1987, was the matriarch of area golf, T. Cleland is reigning royalty. And she has been impressive at the state and national levels, winning 2 New York State seniors, 3 consecutive state mid-ams, been on 3 New York teams in the USGA State Team Championships, played in 6 of the last 8 USGA mid-ams, and the last 5 consecutive USGA seniors. T placed 5th in the 2012 North-South Amateur at Pinehurst. She accomplished all that while teaching physical education for 32 years at Corcoran. T retired this year.
She really cared. She really cared about the kids. And you know that especially in phys ed, because usually you don't have a typical classroom. You have an office, and you could see when the girls hung out in her office, you can tell that it was more of a, they respected her. They wanted to, you know, spend time with her, whether it was lunch, whatever. And she just a great mom, grandmother, she probably won't like me saying that, teacher, mentor. And I think the biggest thing about that whole role model piece, and I would say it to the girls especially, she taught a lot of the girls' classes, was if you were an athlete, I would always point to T or Mrs. Cleland and say, if you work hard enough, you could be good at whatever you want to do, because that's exactly what she does.
Son Jeff, a veteran of the Iraq War, was introduced to golf by his mom.
I beat her one time, but I made her play from the blue tees, so I cheated a little bit.
That was at Bellevue, where the self-professed range rat can be found almost daily hitting balls, or on the practice green working on her side saddle putting stroke. Her caddy is like family. Come to think of it, he is family. But why does husband John tote his wife's golf bag in tournaments?
I'm just a calming influence, you know, kind of handle all the travel. She doesn't have to worry about anything. She just got to get her to the golf course on time. And the show up, keep up, and shut up rules of the caddy, I do 2 of them okay. The last one I kind of struggle with.
And who called the shots?
She plays a little too conservative, so I got to really kind of pay attention if, you know, like we had an incident up in Alaska for a qualifier 2 weeks ago where she had 140 in. A, she didn't put the tee shot where I told her to. She had 140 in, and I said, just hit this thing. And so, you know, but she wanted to lay up. She just wanted to chisel a little sand wedge up to 100 yards. I go, no, you don't play golf that way. You had 140 yards in. Hit it. You know, and she put it in the water.
Practice makes perfect. And during off time at school, T could be found at Corcoran's indoor batting range hitting golf balls. At home, there's a 12-foot net so she can hit driver and a putting green in the basement. With T now retired, son Jeff made a prediction.
Her game is going to be exponentially better in the next few years.
Better? Watch out, ladies. And now, 4, please. It's time to induct Teresa T. Cleland into the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame, Class of 2014.
Ladies and gentlemen, T. Cleland.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Induction into the Greater Syracuse Hall of Fame was neither imagined or expected. It is truly an honor. I'd like to thank each and every one of you here tonight that took time out of your busy schedules to be here at Drumlin's to celebrate with all of us up here. Thanks a lot. Growing up, I pretty much played every sport but golf. And it wasn't until after my collegiate career at Niagara University had ended and my two reconstructive knee surgeries later that I figured I'd better find something else to do. And I figured, well, what about that game of golf? It looks easy enough. Well, I couldn't have been more sadly mistaken. But I soon found out with golf that it was a sport that I could practice as much as I wanted to. And hopefully, if I was practicing the right things, I could improve. So golf, for me, gave me a second chance. It gave me a mulligan. All along the way, though, I've received so much support from so many people. And I wanted to start by thanking my family. I grew up in a home where athletics and participation in athletics was encouraged and supported. And I thank them for that. Here with me tonight is my brother Chris and my sister-in-law Catherine, my sister Mary and my brother-in-law Vin, and my mom Ruth. My own three children, my daughters Jessica and Jill, and my son Jeff, all three are talented high school and collegiate athletes. And growing up, we had some busy, crazy schedules. They will say that I supported them in everything they did, but the truth of it is, they really supported me unconditionally. They knew what I was trying to do, and whether I had a good day on a golf course or a bad day, they were proud that their mom was the biggest jock that they knew. Here tonight with me is my daughter Jessica and her boyfriend Paul from Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. My daughter Jill and her husband Mark live in Kodiak, Alaska, and they weren't able to make the trip. And my son Jeff is here, and Jeff, thanks for being part of the video. Jeff's wife Kim was not able to make it. She's home with my three-week-old granddaughter Charlotte and my 14-month-old grandson Colton. So that's my next foursome right there. My husband John. This guy has caddied for me in 15 national championships, dozens of national qualifying sites. We've traveled the country and played some of the most challenging and beautiful golf courses there are. I think caddying can be a pretty thankless job, especially when you caddy for your wife, and he takes a lot of good-natured abuse for that. But John caddies with a real insight to the game of golf and really a sense of humor. We were just playing in Indianapolis a month ago in the U.S. Women's Mid-Am, and we were checking the distance on a long par four, our second shot. And I pulled my 5-iron out of the bag, and I turned to John and I said, will the 5 get me there? And his immediate answer was, eventually. And he handed me, not what you want to hear from your caddy. And he handed me a fairway wood and said, go ahead and hit this, you'll be better with this. But John, I can't thank you enough for everything. And I sure wouldn't want anyone else being my caddy. But Jeff, be ready, you might get the call one of these days. Lastly, I'd like to thank a city and a community, a city I was born and raised in, a Northside Italian, a school district I proudly taught in for 32 years, and just a community of wonderful people. I'd like to thank my longtime instructor, Jay Catalano. Jay always believed in me, and together we set some pretty lofty goals. My fellow Bellevue Country Club members, and my fellow Syracuse Women's District Golf Association members, a number of them who are here tonight, and I think it's really just to see me in attire other than my baseball cap and my golf clothes. But I would like everyone to know that their support, their friendship, their kind words, and their encouragement have not gone unnoticed or unappreciated. Snyder asked me in a recent interview to name my most memorable win. And without skipping a beat, I said it hasn't happened yet. For me, this journey continues. There's lots more practice to be done. There's many more tournaments to be played. But no matter where this game takes me, I proudly represent Syracuse in this community. Thank you again to the Hall of Fame for this incredible honor. Congrats to my fellow inductees on all of their wonderful accomplishments. And I am proud to be a member of the class of 2014 with you gentlemen. Thank you.
T. Cleland. And the 28th Annual Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame Induction Ceremonies will continue on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Welcome back to the Tully's Good Times 2014 Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame Induction Ceremony on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Some 8 years ago, the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame added a new feature to our event with the special recognition of a team of honor. Tonight, we honor, from 1966 to 1983, the Liverpool High School swimming team.
Liverpool Swimming, a program without a pool. Ah, but build it and they will come. Swimmers, divers, by the family full. And before some folks can spell funicello properly, Liverpool High School would become a pool power.
Well, when I first went there, I made a commitment to the student body that we were going to become one of the powers of the state. And so I believed it from day one.
They did not lose there. Not once in their own pool, not on Hall of Famer Jim Funicello's watch, 1966 to 1983. And over the course of 113 meets, the Warriors did not lose, home or away. Was there mounting pressure not to be on the team which ended the streaks?
There was some pressure, but we kind of savored that. That was what made it so fun.
Along the way of 9 New York State titles, 15 consecutive sectional crowns, and an overall record of 215-5, there was that one shining moment.
Coach wanted to set a goal to win this. It's like a national high school championship, very close in that day, about being that as close as it could get. He wanted to win that. Jim went there and said we could win it. We're all kind of like, really, these people are. Here we are in Liverpool, New York. We're going to go there and win this. And he really had us set up. He trained us to go there and win that. I would say when we went there, we won that. That was a really cool moment for all of us.
The first New York team to win the big one in the modern era. Liverpool swam away from the field, beating the best up and down the East Coast by a resounding 42 points. The next year, the pool was edged by 79 runner-up Nova of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Having coached so many great teams, Funicello would not single out one as his best.
Probably the era between 78 and 83 were the more dominant kinds of athletes.
Swimmers came, swimmers went. Siblings came, siblings went. A tradition of winning was built on the foundation of family.
We moved from Illinois to Syracuse, and my father specifically said, we're moving to Liverpool because there's an excellent swim coach, and that proved out to be true for many reasons, including for all the lessons you learn, not just swimming.
A coach, a salesman, a disciplinarian, all in one.
You know, it was never about winning. He almost never talked about winning. It was always about the preparation to the meets and the practices and the discipline and showing up to practices on time. I can't even remember one instance where he talked about winning.
He could sell it to an athlete in a gym to get him to try something. And next thing you know, he expanded his program that way. I think he gravitated people into a sport that normally wouldn't go because of his ability to sell. And you trusted him. He had trust.
There were titles won and individuals honored. 21 high school All-Americans, including the late Hall of Famer Don Langenmeyer, more than 40 years ago, and John Nation, who at the moment battles cancer in Louisville, Kentucky. The Warriors were not seasonal swimmers. Summers were spent in AAU competition with the Liverpool Jets. There was water polo in the fall.
I think we all went through these unbelievably difficult practices, 6 o'clock in the morning at outdoors at Burnett Park Pool, and the water was freezing and we were tired, and it was tough then, but now looking back, I think those are the things that we cherish the most and remember the most.
He always had, from a freshman up to a junior, if you were even a senior, he would never let you get comfortable. If you got comfortable, he'd say, well, I got this person, you know, they're working out hard. He would always have a lot of pressure on us through our training.
We were the first school in Liverpool to weight train. We were in the pool 5 o'clock every morning, not in the pool, but in the weight room, weight training. And that was probably the biggest secret of the success of that program.
Coach Funicello is most proud not of titles won, but surprisingly perhaps, in a rare defeat.
Back in 1982, We had a long win streak. I forget how many, maybe 115 we hadn't lost. We went to Fairport, and we knew that they were going to be very tough to beat, and we didn't beat them. They beat us on their home court. It was a humongous crowd. And at the end, when I knew I had made it as a coach and a teacher, is at the end, my team surrounded the pool while they were all jumping in and applauded them. That was my favorite spot in my whole career.
The mark of a real champion. Glorious in victory, gracious in defeat. That is why Liverpool swimming from 1966 to 1983 is the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame Team of Honor. Accepting this recognition on behalf of Liverpool swimming, former swim team member and coach Kerry Quilty.
Well, this is a great honor and privilege for me tonight to be here to accept, and on behalf of all of the members of the Liverpool swim team, this great award to participate of all the teams from 1966 to 83. You know, we would like to certainly thank the Greater Syracuse Hall of Fame Committee and board members for recognizing our outstanding program to be included with this great outstanding group of individuals at this head table here, and to certainly in all the previous inductees, and including Athletic Hall of Fame coach Jim Funicello, our coach, who was inducted as well. So we really appreciate this great honor. You know, when you think of all the unique individuals that we've had on the Liverpool swim program, swim team, in all the years from the 60s through this time period, and all the individual coaches, you know, we're all different teams, but I would like to share a couple things that we all had in common. And the first one is that we all had to be entirely crazy and nuts to do the things that we had to do. It was incredible. There was a quote as you walked in to the pool that read on the bottom of the record board that said, "To be good takes practice. To be great takes more practice." And as you know from this great video, there were some tremendous great teams, and Coach Funicello certainly brought the more practice aspect part to a new level, especially for those teams in the late 60s and early. But no one did the type of things we did. His innovations and things that he did were just, you know, just incredible stuff that we did. But when you choose, and we all chose to be a part of the Liverpool swim program, we really became, it became a lifestyle for us. And, you know, and on behalf of all those swimmers and divers that were part of this program, you know, I know we would all love to say thanks to our parents for all the things that they did. You know, dropping us off at the high school and winners in Syracuse, you know, as Coach said in the video, you know, 5 a.m, you know, of weight training in the pools, all the double sessions, the Saturday sessions, the off season. We knew that we went to practice, that suffering was optional, but pain was inevitable, okay? And that, but yet Coach made it fun. He was a master motivator. And most importantly, he made us believe in our preparation. And I think it was that work ethic, that commitment that we all shared together that bonded each and every one of our teams and all of us individually to make us become a great program. And I think those are the things that really helped. To be good takes practice, and to be great takes more practice. Now, the second thing that really kind of, I thought, brought us in common, and really the most important thing, and it's shared with all the people up here, and that is what this real program is really all about. And that is the building of our character. You know, if character can be defined as the sum of our virtues, this program helped us with defining our virtues. It was about learning about the commitment, about learning about loyalty, learning about responsibility. Practice started at 2:27. You better be 10 minutes early before you're 1 second late. It was about leadership. It was about respect. It was about who you are when nobody else was learning. And, you know, as Coach shared with you in that video, you know, it wasn't about all the great things, the success that this team had, but it was that moment, as Coach said, one of the greatest moments he had as a coach. And that when 113 meets, streets meets, and all of a sudden, you know, most teams, they lose, and the kids might drop their heads. These kids got that. That team got it. We've all got that. We all would have done those things as they standed up and applauded the other team for their congratulations. And so, and really, that is what this program was all about. You know, I would like to, you know, thank Coach Funicello for being one of the greatest influences in my life, and also an influence on all of us that he had for us with our program. And it's really what was accomplished after school that what this program is all about. So congratulations to all of to all the team members, not only all of our swimmers and divers, but to the parents, to all the siblings, to all the friends of Liverpool Swimming, to Coach Jerry Elliott, who was a longtime coach in the program for junior varsity years, and to Coach Funicello, our extended family. You know, it's amazing what can be accomplished when no one cares who gets the credit. And lastly, I will just say that a quote that we were all kind of ingrained from the coach, and it kind of exemplifies why we're here tonight, that winning was just a byproduct of our preparation. And as a result of that, we accept this award tonight and with great honor, and it's a great privilege to be for me to stand here tonight on behalf of all of those people involved. Thank you very much.
Nice to be done, Terry. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Liverpool Swimming. Our next inductee, Gerhard Schwedes.
Before gridiron glory, there was a childhood taste of war and memories that never leave you. Gerhard "Ger" Schwedes would experience the greatest day in the annals of Syracuse football, as up close and personal as delivering an historic 87-yard touchdown pass into the hands of an iconic Ernie Davis in the Cotton Bowl. Captain Ger and Coach Ben Schwartzwalder's Orange Men, unbeaten and king of the hill. But long before, there had been war. In Nazi Germany, Gerhard's childhood experience included fighter planes shooting overhead and the air raid warning, a cuckoo sound signaling an imminent attack. Time to head to your bunker. Post-war, there were no rations. A young Ger attached hooks to four empty tomato cans and got food for the family from our GIs. After 3 years in a French POW camp, his father came home, on foot. By comparison, Ben Schwartzwalder's practices were a piece of cake. Schwedes arrived on U.S. soil nearly 65 years ago at age 11. The family settled in New Jersey, where Ger would later meet Jan Erik Camford.
Well, we met on the football practice field at Flemington High School. He had a four-year head start on me in this country, and so he helped pave the way for me.
They were teammates.
He was a star running back, and I was one of those interior linemen. So, you know, I had the opportunity to block for him. Not always to his satisfaction, I might add.
And they were stepbrothers.
I found myself in a pretty challenging family situation with my family. And thanks to his friendship, his parents opened up their home for me and invited me in. And his parents became my legal guardian. And we became brothers.
The leading rusher on the 1958 Orange Bowl team, Schwedes found himself under center for the 59 opener against John Hadle-led Kansas. Starting quarterback Bob Thomas was sidelined following a back surgery.
It was Ben's idea to move Gerhard in at quarterback. And he adjusted. Ger was a sharp, sharp player.
With young quarterback Dave Surrett coming in and playing well, Ger moved to right halfback, and the rest is Orange history. Of all Ger's attributes, speed was not one of them.
I saw him play many times on film, and as well as seeing Ernie Davis and some of those other great running backs, and I sort of developed my own abilities. Of course, I had the speed that was much greater than his.
But Gerhard possessed other skills.
Gerhard was really a very versatile player. He could throw as a halfback. He could run, as you know. He could catch the ball. He was a wonderful receiver coming out of the backfield. He took us from that shaky period that we were going into the Kansas game, and his maturity really carried over into the ball club. That entire year, people don't realize the impact that he had on that team.
Not just 16 touchdowns he scored in 1959, topped only by Floyd Little, then Walter Reyes. I had a chance to play with a lot of guys during my college and pro days, said Orange teammate and tackle Maury Yeomans. But there isn't anyone I played with who comes close to the desire that Gerhard played with in 1959 and still has today. Schwedes received All-American recognition, was an academic All-American, and a National Football Foundation and College Hall of Fame scholar-athlete. He was the first pick of the AFL's Boston Patriots.
I'm willing to bet that Gerhard and Ben had the best relationship, coach-captain relationship of all of his teams at Syracuse.
Ben was going to move Bruce Tarbox to second team, Yeomans recalled. Gerhard spoke for all of us, except maybe his replacement, that we were winning with this team and we didn't want to see him make the change. No change was made.
Even to this day, he's still considered the captain of that team among the teammates when we get together for various reunions.
A 1984 Syracuse University letter winner of distinction, the captain, Gerhard Schwedes, is now a member of the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame, class of 2014.
Ladies and gentlemen, Gerhard Schwedes.
Dankeschön, es freut mich, dass ich jetzt, looking at that little movie shtick, it reminds me that the older I get, the better I was. When it was first announced that I was to be inducted in this august society, my wife pulled out the tux. And when I first tried it on, it was here. So we've been working on it, and we're almost there. As an incentive, she gave me a sweatshirt that said, "I have the body of a god. Too bad it's Buddha." The committee limits us to 3 to 5 minutes of our talks. Hell, I've had coughing spells longer than that. Sorry, Father. I've had some serious back problems about 4 years ago. And to make this as quickly as I can, I went through 4 years of epidural shots. Every 3 months, I got 2 shots, and sometimes it helped, sometimes it didn't. And after 4 years, when I went for 3 months at the end, it didn't work. So I dropped it, and I went to 4 sessions of acupuncture, and I'm sorry to say that didn't work either. So someone recommended a young surgeon here in town, and remember his name. His name is Aaron Bianco. I went in to see him, and he's after myriads of tests. He said, all those 4 years were wasted because nothing would have helped you. What you've got is a large cyst on your spinal cord. He said, I can fix it. But if we get any leakage, we're in deep trouble. I said, what do you mean if? He said, we'll do it. And the only thing I ask of you If this, I said, what do you mean if? If this is successful, that you take me out for a round of golf. I made him a promise too. I said, if this thing works out, I'm gonna kiss you right on the lips. We haven't played golf yet. I've no idea where he is. I'd like to congratulate the recipients at the desk. It is quite an honor. And there's some thank yous in order. The first one is to a lady by the name of Mary Lou Personis Schwedes, who gave me two great sons, and they're here. The second one, the second thank you goes to Linda Williams Schwedes, who raised them in their formative years. Thank you, Linda. Speaking of Scott and Eric, Eric's 51, Scott's 49, that makes me over 40. About 5 years ago, we were at the Brewster Inn for Father's Day. And after the dinner, Scott reached under the table and pulled out a 3-wood Callaway, brand new. I said, Scotty, that's a lot of money to spend for Father's Day, but you know, I appreciate it and I'll take it. Eric said, Dad, he couldn't hit it. I'd like to thank Bill Dutch, my mentor, and Billy, you deserve a hand. I especially would like to thank my corporate sponsor, Frito-Lay, and my good friend, Larry Quinn, who's in the audience. Larry, thank you. I'd like to thank my teammates, and I think 5 or 6 of them are here tonight. I'd ask them to stand, but they're all too rickety. I'd like to thank Ben Schwartzwalder. I'm sure a lot of you heard about that guy, Tough Ben. I got the last scholarship in 1956. My high school football coach brought me up from New Jersey and took me up to the university. And Ben, I don't know why, gave me a scholarship. And I really don't know why. My junior year, our football was canceled because one of our players got polio. My senior year, we were 0-8, and we played our arch rival, Washington, in the state of New Jersey. They were 0-8. We lost 49-0. But I really think why Ben gave me the scholarship is because my high school football coach was in the Navy with Rocco Piro. And they had one left and couldn't find anybody else. But I'm forever grateful. I was introduced to football in 1945. Luckily, I live in the American sector in a city, Ulm, in southern Germany. So when the war ended in 1945, they brought in, I think it was around 5,000 GIs from the Rainbow Division in Texas, and they adopted us kids. They were absolutely phenomenal, fantastic. As it said in the intro, every night I had 2 cans, wire in each hand, and for almost 2.5, 3 years, I stood in line when the GIs were having their evening mess, and they fed us for 2.5, 3 years. They're absolutely fantastic. Then there were no filter cigarettes. They saved all their butts, even cut off the end, so we get pure tobacco, and we take the tobacco. Jeez, who put this there? We put the tobacco into boxes, cigar boxes, and we actually traded those things. A box of tobacco, which was the currency of exchange, there was no money, went for two rabbits, two chickens, or whatever you could barter for. They were just terrific. I had a laundry route, went in to pick up their laundry. I remember I was 7 years old, and I used to haul some laundry. My grandmother, my aunt, and my mother did the laundry, and the GIs gave us, some of you are probably old enough to remember Kirk soap, K-I-R-K, looked just like a brick. And what we do is slice the soap, use portion to do the laundry, and we barter the rest of the soap for necessities that the family needed. The GIs played, we had a curfew in that part of Germany. It didn't get dark around 10:30 at night during the summer. The GIs used to go out and they'd play softball out in the street, and they'd throw this, what we called Eierball, which is an egg ball, football. And if they threw it too far, we'd scamper out the window and steal them until we figured out there was nothing we could do with the things. So we threw them back in the street when they showed up. We also, they were still on maneuvers, they were still in a war mode. So what they used to do is put these field phones out in the field, and fortunately for us kids, they left them unguarded. Our parents didn't have phones, but we did. I gotcha. All right, I'll cut it short. I'm forever grateful to those GIs. That's where I learned to speak English. And because of my relationship with them, taught me some self-reliance, gave me some confidence. And I'd like to tell you just a short little vignette about the 59 season. Do you know Syracuse never had an undefeated year? We went undefeated 59 at the end, but we lost to Oklahoma. It's a real serendipity question. We started all 11 games with the same 11 guys. That's totally unbelievable. Surrett, our quarterback, couldn't see. So I got the signals from Ben and gave them to Surrett. He'd call the plays. Now, Dick Easterly, I was second in the country in scoring. Easterly still maintains that every time Ben called a play within a 10-yard line, he says, you called your own plays, didn't you? As a team, we endow three players up there, so we believe in the university. We support the university, and to date, I think we've given at least $500,000 to support the football program. Then I'll just give you a real little quickie. We played Boston University. They had a pretty good team. But at the end of the half, we were only leading 12-0. Ben was so PO'd he wouldn't come into the locker room. He sent Rocco Piro in to see whether we could speed things up a bit. So as we came out, I called the signals from Schwartzwalder to Surrett. And what I saw is, I just happened to look over the BU side. As soon as we called our play, they called the play into their defense, and they stacked us. They knew exactly what we were going to run. And the way they did it is they filmed the Pittsburgh game where we played before and filmed Ben at the same time. They put two and two together, and they got the right four. So they knew every play. When Ben called the plays, whatever the hand signals were, if I went like this, that means, Ben, you just keep calling, and we'll run our own play. So boom, 46-0, we ended up. All right. Another rarity in football is we had the most tremendous line. We have records that will never, ever be broken. Can you imagine giving up 198 yards rushing in a whole season? three-quarters of a yard attempt in rushing is what we held him to, but I won't believe the statistics. And we did it without any players from Florida. When Ben said we were going to go south for the bowl, the Cotton Bowl was in the running. We had, and this is important, we had meetings, the chancellor, Ben Schwartzwalder, the athletic director, Lou Andreas, and I, we sat down. Jim Brown couldn't get a haircut in 1957 when he played in the Cotton Bowl, and he had some problems down there. We weren't going to let that happen. So we had meetings of what we're going to do to make sure our three black players wouldn't have any problems. We got in touch with the chaplain at Houston University where we practiced prior to the game and made sure that the black players had enough entertainment, whatever. But as a team, we vowed, if they can't go there, we won't go there. And just to prove the point, in the victory celebration in the hotel, our black players had to leave the hotel at 9 o'clock. There wasn't a Syracuse player in the joint. Yep. In closing, I'm humbled to be honored. And I dedicate my induction to the coaches, the staff, the administration, and the 65 players we had on that terrific squad. 50 of them are still with us. We're getting together for the Duke game because two of our guys are getting inducted in Letterman Distinction. And to this day, those 65 are still my best friends. Thank you.
The 28th Annual Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame induction ceremonies will continue on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Welcome back to the Tully's 2014 Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame induction ceremony on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Ladies and gentlemen, our next inductee, Bob Snyder.
There comes that time when you realize you're not going to be the next Harold Pee Wee Reese or Jackie Roosevelt Robinson. From all-star little leaguer to high school starter to why can't you hit the sharp breaking ball? Basketball? Same story. Scoring a record 27 points in the Daily Orange WAER game just doesn't cut it. An 8.5 hour, 50-game nonstop bowling marathon, which earned you $50, proves only that your 10 fraternity brothers, who each wagered $5 you couldn't do it, were cheap. So when you no longer can play the game, why not write about those who can? Your Daily Orange column, Snide Remarks, stays with you your entire career. You prove your lack of business acumen upon returning from active duty in Korea by going to work for $105 a week at the Herald Journal, Herald American, routinely working 50 hours plus, $2 an hour. You gotta love it. Snide's loved it for more than 40 years, from December 1965 to March 2006.
I've known Snide since I was a student at SU way back in the early 1980s. And when you work for WAR, the student radio station, or the Daily Orange, you're always a little bit in awe when you go to cover SU games of the people who do it for a living, the sports writers and the sports anchors who work in the Syracuse market. I can't believe Snide's is just now getting inducted into this Hall of Fame, because when I was a student more than 30 years ago, he was already a legend in that market. And as far as we were concerned, just the opportunity to go to a game and meet Bob Snyder was a thrill.
He wrote about Syracuse Chiefs baseball.
He went always the extra distance to get more if he could get out of you.
I got to know him very well when I became the broadcaster for the Syracuse Chiefs for 3 years, 1982 through 84. Snides covered the team regularly, and Snides is a great nickname because the Chiefs weren't very good in those days, and he was always good for a snide comment or two. from the press box. And one of the things that struck me back then is he was always a very cool guy. He must be very cool because even in the middle of summer, when it'd be 85 degrees and humid out, Snyder would show up to the game wearing that black turtleneck and a black sweater over it. So I don't know what that's all about, but maybe that's the kind of body temperature that a Hall of Famer has.
Snyder climbed stadium stairs when a fire gutted Big Mac in 1969, and he wrote volumes about SU basketball.
The only guy in Syracuse that's seen more games than I have, probably. He understands Syracuse University football and basketball as well as anybody. That doesn't mean he understands it well, but he understands it better than most anybody else, and he's been an avid follower of Syracuse sports forever.
What did the coaching fraternity think of him?
They respected Snyder because of his fairness.
Snyder was courtside in Providence as the 1975 Cinderella Orangemen shocked hoop fans along Tobacco Road en route. California, here we come.
Great chronicler of Syracuse sports. Great writer, great knowledge of the game and the people in the game, and knowledge of this city.
In 1980, he wrote about Louis Orr's driving layup at the buzzer to beat St. John's in Queens, then drove to Lake Placid, the miracle on ice, sporting event of the century. While he'll never be a single-digit handicap, not even close, as tournament director, he grew the Herald Amateur into the largest golf tournament of its kind in the country. He covered the Ryder Cup. He was at the Masters in 1999 and 2001 when he observed every swing all week taken by future Hall of Famer Tom Scherer. And again in 2005, walking Amen Corner over and over again. During all these years, there were hundreds of national magazine pieces written, a couple of books, co-hosting a basketball post-game TV show for 17 years, and SU Radio color commentary for three more.
Always fair, always hardworking, always well prepared. You didn't have an axe to grind, and you have comported yourself and dealt in the world of sports media like a true Hall of Famer should.
Snyder won more than a few awards, but the greatest was being privileged to write for so many years, for so many people, and always doing it his way.
Not a guy you always agree with, but you know, as a coach, you're not supposed to always agree with a sports writer. That would be bad policy. But Bob Snyder was as good as anybody.
And tonight, Bob Snyder enters the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame, Class of 2014.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Snyder!
Thank you, Doug, and thank you, Jimmy. Members of the head table, and ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here and supporting the Hall of Fame. None of us arrived tonight at this dais without the help of others. I think we'll all agree to that. Neither coach, athlete, administrator, or a broken-down old sports writer columnist. Enjoying even a modicum of success in the press box meant I had a publisher and editors that believed in my ability to whet the appetite of readers year after year, decade after decade. We were not always on the same page, so to speak. Occasionally I was benched. I didn't cover this game or that one. But the next day I wrote as I always had. And with time, old Snyder remarks simply wore him down. Let's face it, mine's been a charmed life. I was there for more memorable moments than one guy should be allowed to enjoy. From those at Big Mac to Shea, Manly to Madison Square Garden, Lake Placid to San Diego, Oak Hill to Augusta National. Even as a teenager, I wrote a speech, an essay, I should say, stating my career ambition, sports writer. Mom kept that essay for years, even if her unspoken words spoke volumes that she wished I would be an attorney like my dad. I hope they're proud of my modest achievements. While Snyder the scribe marched to his own drummer, I did manage to be influenced as a collegian interning one summer in Binghamton. Thank you, John Fox, for showing me how a columnist should write. And thanks, Larry Kimball, SU Sports Information Director Emeritus, for a friendship that's more than a working relationship between SID and beat writer columnist. Family's always been supportive. My sister Pat, my brother Lou, who is here with the rest of the family, Sandy, Matt, Brandon, Ryan, Rachel. Thanks, gang, for making the trip. A contingent is here from Radisson and Radisson Greens Golf Club, the best layout in central New York and now restored to its natural beauty. Now, I have a reputation at Radisson that is richly undeserved. And I know that a lot of the guys really came out here tonight out of a sense of guilt because they've taken so much money from me over so many years. And starting tomorrow, they'll take more. My greatest supporters are the two most important people in my life. Marcia, my wife of what'll be 44 years next month. Provided family stability while following her professional dream just as I followed mine. The love of our lives, our beautiful daughter Leslie, has been a constant joy to us, a more talented writer than her old man. You put a driver in her hand and she'll hit a tee shot by me in the air. Yes, I've interviewed them all, the biggest names in halls of fame, including most of the more than 200 inductees in our town's sports shrine, and most of them that are here tonight. Now, in my world, there are no heroes in sports, just stars. I wrote after 9/11, I'd never use hero again in a sports context, and I never did. I know kids look up to athletes, and that's fine, but in my world, not as heroes, as great athletes and stars. I did refer to Pat Tillman, killed by friendly fire in Afghanistan, as a hero. But that was for leaving millions on the table and choosing to fight for his country and die for his country. Not for catching a pass or throwing a block. Hitting a three at the buzzer is, to me, not heroic. The guy's a star. The guy wins the game. He's not a hero. I'll tell you what sports writing is all about. For me, it's been the opportunity to share emotional journeys with my readers. Like one I took more than 25 years ago with Paul Flynn. Flynn was a Chittenango High senior who ran track and cross country. He ran, notwithstanding a battle with cystic fibrosis. He had diabetes, and his day was one of 19 pills, 5 insulin shots, and a great deal of coughing. And yet this 19-year-old kid was a nozzle man on North Chittenango's volunteer fire company. For a cystic, I've had some perfect days. Get up in the morning, that's perfect. Going in the hospital, then coming out, that's perfect, Flinny told me. Paul was not the fastest runner, just the toughest. His courage was heroic. and it was an honor and a privilege for me to write about him. Your column is still hanging on the wall, Carolyn Flynn told me, years after her son had passed away. When your words bring both a smile and a tear, you've hit a home run. I hope I hit more than a few out of the park. Someone once told me I was the perfect bridge between old school sports writing and the current variety. I'll accept that graciously, but I admit if it's 51% one way, 49 the other, I hope 51 is old school. And I guess if I could impart one word of wisdom to young journalists not wishing to pontificate just from years of experience, it's to write with heart, to write with fairness, to write with feeling, to write with emotion. If you can't be emotional when you're writing about a kid like Paul Flynn, you ought not be writing. While this ink-stained wretch may not be worthy of sharing this dais with these Hall of Famers and all the Hall of Famers that preceded you, I am certainly honored to do so. Thank you all very much.
And the 2014 Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame induction ceremonies will continue on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Welcome back to the Tully's 2014 Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame induction ceremony on Time Warner Cable Sports Channel. Ladies and gentlemen, our final inductee, Bill Jones. On the court, he'd point the way. On the diamond, he'd turn the double play. Point guard, second baseman, and a pretty fair golfer as well. Billy Jones was an athlete for all seasons at St. John the Evangelist.
Well, my father was his little league baseball coach at West End PVA, which was located at Lewis Park behind St. Bridget's Church. And my father coached him all the way through Little League. He was an exceptionally good player, and he was very athletic, even at that young of an age. You could tell that he had some abilities that other people did not have.
Father John Fetcho assisted the elder Hayes in coaching young Jones.
He was good, whatever he did. I mean, he put 100% into whatever he did, and if there's somebody is good or better, he would be competitive.
Jones played for St. Bridget's Grammar School and was a cog for the state Biddy basketball tournament champions, who reached the 1954 national semifinals and 55 finals. Jones played with Hall of Famer Gene Fish.
In 1954, when they went out to Peoria, I believe they lost the first game that they played to the best player in the tournament was, his name was Vinnie Ernst, and he was Mr. Biddy League Basketball in the United States the previous year. And his team beat Syracuse, but then Syracuse went on and won five consecutive games to end up the third best team in the tournament.
At Johns, he was an all-parochial league selection in three sports, and Hall of Fame coach Bob Velasco's Cagers won the 1957 playoffs and 58 regular season and playoffs. The 1959 grad was among the school's top 20, named the parochial league's all-time top 200 basketball players. And who was the league's first to be named the Italian-American Athletic Club's Student Athlete of the Year? Billy Jones.
Exactly, scrappiness and determination. I mean, that's the only way I can describe him. He just left it all out there on the basketball court and in the baseball field. Just left it all out there, and there was, he gave no quarter. Even in our pickup games that we had, basketball in his backyard and so on.
Matt Utis went to CBA and met Jones at St. Jerome's in Canada. He knew Billy was small, but...
Strongest player like that that I've ever played against. Well, it was one exception. I played with Jimmy Brown up to Archibald Gym a couple times, but he would just run over you. Bill was more finesse.
He was an excellent shooter, and he could penetrate, and he was just an all-around good athlete.
Jones had been recruited by DePaul legend Ray Meyer, among others, but chose instead a self-disciplined lifestyle. Entering the seminary, an affiliation with the University of Waterloo allowed Billy to continue playing basketball.
When you look at Bill, you see a point guard body, but in his own mind, he was a shooting guard, and there never was a shot he didn't like, but he wasn't a selfish player. Usually the shots that he took were good shots, and he made most of them.
Transferring across the border to a seminary at St. Bonaventure, rules prevented him from continuing to play college hoops.
Billy was a very unique guy, a very humble man, always was, even back then, as a young man, with everything that he had accomplished up to that point and still was about to accomplish while he was in Canada, of course. At St. Jerome's, he had some great games, high-scoring games. He averaged 33 points the first year, 26 the second year. And he set a record, Canadian scoring record, I think, of almost 1,000 points in one season back then. But he had other things on his mind, obviously, and he only played for 2 years, and then he went into the seminary at Christ the King. And the rest is history. You know him for who he is today, and he's had a remarkable life.
Ordained in 1967, Father Bill Jones is currently parochial vicar at the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception. Tonight, we recognize Billy Jones as a member of the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame, Class of 2014. Ladies and gentlemen, Bill Jones.
Well, the other day I was playing golf with one of my good friends, golf partner, and I was bemoaning the fact that I had to tell my life story in 5 minutes. And he said, "What's the problem? You only need two." And these are my friends. When I received word that I was going to be inducted into the Hall of Fame, I met with my elderly aunt, Jane, and we were having lunch, and I says, "Aunt Jane, something very wonderful happened to me the other day. I got a call that I was going to be inducted into the Greater Syracuse Hall of Fame." And there was like a silence and a look. She's my mother's sister. I remember that look, you know? And she said the same thing to me that she said to me 55 years ago when I told her I was going to make the Parochial League All-Stars. And she says, "Billy, you be careful, you're going to get a big head." Right? Guys, okay. But I extend my congratulations to the new inductees here. Again, back to that press conference in June, as I sat there and listened to your achievements and your accomplishments, I stood in awe. And then I began to realize how my honor is so greatly enhanced by coming to the Hall of Fame with you. So we say, Lord, it's good to be here. It's especially good to be here with you. I offer my thanks to so many of my teammates that are here right now tonight, without whom I would not be standing here, and you know that.
In my day at St. John the Evangelist, we had so many good, if not great, athletes. And there are a number of players that could have stepped in to replace me, and the team would have not lost a beat. And I say that humbly. But I am grateful to my teammates who are here tonight for the way you supported me and challenged me to be the best I could be and more. And you know who you are. Thank you for competing with me and against me. I can tell you at St. John the Evangelist, the practices were so intense and so competitive. And I don't want to be cynical, but sometimes we play these games on Friday night and we say, oh, what a cakewalk. We would ask the janitors to leave the lights on so that we could go out, choose up sides, and play for a couple more hours. From the time I was in sixth grade all the way through 12th grade, surprisingly enough, I only had two coaches. First of all, I want to single out Mr. Bob Hayes. Thank you, Bob Hayes Jr., for that interview. I chose you because I know you were there and you had firsthand witness of this. But Bob Hayes coached our Little League championship teams at Lewis Park. And then for 2 years in a row, he led us to the city championship in Biddy League basketball, state championship. And then we went to two national tournaments. Can you imagine in Little League going to two World Series? But that's the kind of caliber that we were playing at. And one thing I remember him about the most is he was the first one that, in his own nice way, got me to do some introspection. And after one day, after what I would call a very unsportsmanlike performance, to put it mildly, he said something like this. He says, you know, sports can build character. It's already been stated. Phil did a great job. But he says, not necessarily. Look at the sports world today. But he says, I'll tell you this, Bill. Sports and competition will reveal what character is there already. That set me back. Because he said, you know, how you perform, how you compete is a reflection of you, but your family, your church, and your school. And being a person probably 11 years old, I began to look in the mirror, you know, and began to, it took a long time, still looking in the mirror, working on my character defects. And then in high school, I was lucky to have Bob Falasco. He's a Hall of Famer here as my baseball and basketball coach. Bob made us go through the fundamentals. That's what I remember over and over and over again. Passing, running, shooting, doing all these drills. And if you didn't do them right, you did them over. Even so that we wouldn't even scrimmage and we'd be so frustrated in this. His philosophy was that then when you scrimmage, boy, you put yourself into it. You appreciated that. And he, I'm grateful that he pushed and pushed and pushed to get the best out of me and even more. Many lessons I learned, but I still have this poem. I'm not going to read it tonight. We're pressed for time. It's Don't Quit. Don't Quit. Don't Quit. And that, it bode me well going into the seminary, all those long, lonely years. Don't quit, don't quit. The end's going to come. And then it bode me very well as a priest, you know. Somehow I thought I was ready to play the game against all the odds. And I always feel any little accomplishment is a great victory, you know, especially when the odds are stacked against you. And I thought I brought that with me from St. John the Evangelist playing with Bob Falasco and my teammates. His style of coaching, I don't want to go to the statistics, but you know, in my last 3 years at Evangelist, we only lost four baseball games. We won two parochial championships, one city championship. And, you know, we only had about 11 guys on the team. And I think the games we lost were like runners-up, second place. So I think we only lost one game in regular season. And his signals were always very simple. You know, he, I don't know if he was in the Army, but he had this rule, keep it simple, stupid. You know, he knew what he was doing. And then, of course, basketball was his specialty, our specialty. And all 4 years that I was at St. John the Evangelist, we made the parochial league finals, which was really big in Syracuse in those days. We won twice, and then we added a regular season championship. One quick note about an assistant coach. It's already been mentioned, Father John Fecho here, long life friend. When I got too old for Little League, somehow he got me to come up to Bellevue and start caddying, and that's when I got hooked on golf. Bobby Hayes was working there in the pro shop. I think Jimmy Conroy, they're all sitting back there. And after hours, after they were finishing clubs and all, I went out and caddied for them. And then sometimes they let me hit a few shots. Then after a while, well, I won't say it, but I have some of their money now. Thanks, guys. But, you know, especially John Fecho, being my mentor and being always there, I think from him what I learned, and I had to bring this with me, and I have to do it every day, and every day part of my prayer is the desire in my field of work. I pray for the desire that I will be able to bear in mind what other people have to bear in my heart. That's the lesson John taught me, and that's what carries me through all court press every day in my life. I am most grateful that God gave me such wonderful parents, steadfast, nourishing, religious in a sense. They taught me how to love God and neighbor, but actually to do something for them. My parents made so many commitments. They gave of themselves so much that I could play athletics when I was a teenager. You know, we didn't even have a home court at St. John's, and we traveled all over the city and blizzards and everything just to practice. I know somehow my parents are here tonight in spirit, beaming down on this momentous event. My two brothers are here tonight, Danny and Dickie, and their families. Four nieces, one nephew, two very special grandnephews. Good hockey players. Already, I think they may have the chance to be in this Hall of Fame. Just ask them. And my three cousins are here. And at one time, around the early 60s, all of us lived probably within 100 yards of, of each other with my grandparents there. And you know what? We got along, and we still do. There are a number of good friends here tonight, near and far. You know, since I have been ordained a priest, I've been blessed with being part of eight special communities, four parishes here in Syracuse, four in the southern tier. And I'm especially grateful for all the people from the southern tier that came up. I think they pretty much cover the gamut. Binghamton going west, Johnson City. We got Endwell, Endicott, Maine. I see John Caveney from Vestal. I can't thank you enough for your support in making this a trip today. You know, one thing, one big mistake I made was to continue to play basketball into my 40s. I was chaplain at the college there in Binghamton, and I was still playing with the kids from New York City, and I paid the price. I don't know what I was trying to prove. Well, I think I know what I was trying to prove, but I paid the price. I've had eight surgeries on my legs. I can tell you life became very difficult at times in my physical ailments and the stress of ministry, and I could tell you I didn't come out in saran wrap. the times of darkness with bouts with depression, addiction to prescription drugs, alcohol, heartbreaking relationships. To my family and friends, you know, you helped me get up again and start over. You know who you are. And you encouraged me to keep moving forward. You stood by me when it really counted. I have been blessed, gifted, graced to have people like you in my life. What we celebrate today in the book and everything, that happened all before I was 20 years old. And I can tell you, the last 50 years have been far more exhilarating, far more fulfilling, far more joyful, far more everything because of the people like you in my life. Thank you. You know, whoever thought that as an athlete who drove himself relentlessly to compete and win would find joy, happiness in his God, surrendering and admitting complete defeat by depression, painkillers, and alcohol. I'm learning that my biggest surrender is producing my greatest joy. In one last paragraph, one day I was chipping and putting. I was helping Joe Tesori with his golf. And he said because he went last year when he was being inducted in the Hall of Fame that you gave him more slack. So if Tesori gets slack, then I get slack. All right, okay. I want to mention a word of thanks to my coach at Waterloo, Dan Puglisi. It's not a household name around here. But because of our success at Waterloo, he went on to work with the Canadian national team there in Ottawa. I had a great visit with him about 8 years ago, right before he passed away. And my athletic director, Carl Trotsky, I still stay in touch with him. And there's this other man in my life, Dr. Gerald Fryer. He was president of University of Waterloo. He had this dream of building Waterloo into this great university. And they had all these little colleges, Waterloo Lutheran, Waterloo Wesleyan, St. Jerome's Resurrection College. And they wanted to unite them, but especially Dan and Carl wanted to put Waterloo on the map. When I went there, they were called the Waterloo Mules. And so it just so happened there's a whole bunch of us recruits from the States, great players, and we went into the Carletons and the Kingstons and Toronto University in Windsor and our own big arch rivals, McMaster, and just blew them away, you know, and they weren't ready for us. The Mules became Warriors. That's your new, but anyway, some people say, someone asked me the other day, is that little school still exist up there? It's about 60 miles west of Toronto, 35 miles northwest of Hamilton. Well, this year we had a reunion of some of the guys that we started with back there in 59, and about 50 people came, not all clergy. And this president of the Catholic section, the University of Waterloo Resurrection College, his sister, or it was Dr. Catherine Braggerman, informed us now that this little college, as someone said, off the map up there in Canada, is now the enrollment of 32,000. And it's all because of me. God bless you.
How about one more round of applause for all of our honorees in the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame Class of 2014. Ladies and gentlemen, as we mentioned at the beginning of the evening, and I hope you'll all agree, with each passing year, the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame indeed becomes even greater. We invite you to visit the Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame at Burdick's Drivers Village in North Syracuse. And you can also visit our website, syracusehalloffame.com. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your continued support of our Greater Syracuse Sports Hall of Fame and for sharing in tonight's celebration. For everyone at Time Warner Cable Sports Channel, thank you for joining us, and so long for now.
As we come.